architect Meera Milan Ajit. She's currently working as a senior architect at L&T Construction, Buildings and Factories. She has worked for various commercial and institutional projects for the Engineering Design Research Center, ranging from shopping malls, IT parks to metro rails. She has attended many national conferences and seminars. She has also worked as a freelancer in Chennai for various projects.
Hello and welcome to UGC Lecture Series in Architecture. I'll be taking you through AR6302, History of Architecture and Culture 3. Today we'll be going through Lecture 4. In the previous lectures, you would have seen the early Christian architecture, how churches evolved from a basic plan, moved on to the Romanist stage and came to the Gothic stage. You would have seen the English Gothic cathedrals, the English Gothic architecture, and in this lecture you will be seeing late medieval period, unit 3, part 2. In the part 1, you went through the English Gothic architecture, and in this lecture you will be seeing the French Gothic architecture and its examples with various architecture features discussed here. Moving on to the content. First, you will be going through the timber roof churches, the French Gothic architecture, then the Notre Dame Paris and the Amiens Cathedral Paris. So, first and foremost, we will be discussing the timber roof in architecture of churches. See, architecture of churches, as you see, maximum used stones and other building materials, and timber became a part of this basically in England towards the Gothic time of construction, that is the late medieval period. So, the English developed this as no other nation did, the construction of timber roofs. So, basically it was elaborate hammer beam variety of construction in the 15th century. So, see, the timber roof was one of the most important feature of English late medieval period construction, especially the Gothic construction. If you see the intrinsic detail of the timber construction or the detailing of the wood enhanced the interior of these parish churches, the English churches, to an extent that it became a landmark of the church construction technique. So, basically if you see timber roof construction evolved, and it as other construction, timber roof construction also evolved from a simple basic construction into an extremely complicated series of construction, giving rise to extremely flamboyant, highly decorated, huge and vast spaces with extreme height to the structure. So, the first type of timber roof that we are going to discuss today is the tie beam roof. The tie beam roof is nothing but the earliest and the simplest style of timber roof construction. It has two rafters pitched against one another with a tie beam at the center. So, now you will ask me, what is a rafter? These are the two rafters and this is the tie beam. The basically simplest of the wooden architecture in the roof started with this, and if you can see in this, this is a typical tie beam roof, and you here you can see the rafters and here you can see the tie beam in between. This is an example of the Trinity Chapel, and see this type of construction was used only during the Norman period. Basically this was the only timber roof construction that was constructed used during the Norman period. So, yeah, Norman period was when this timber roof construction churches started, but then as the timber roof construction evolved and various different types of construction came in, even then the architects or the artists were not willing to give up this form of construction, because if you see, even as this evolved, this form of construction alone was repeatedly used even till the earlier stage of wood and timber roof construction in the churches. So, basically a central king's post truss was used in order to support the tie beam to strengthen the framework. See, this is the king cross truss. King cross truss is nothing but a central, if you put a central truss here in order to support the tie beam, then that is called the king post truss. So, see, the basic difference between the king post truss and queen post truss is queen post truss used two supports, and King Post Trust use only single support for construction. So one example of such timber roof, that is a tie beam construction, is the Morton Church in Lincolnshire. So moving on, the next type of construction is the trust rafter roofs. So trust rafter roof originated later. Basically, I'll tell you, in timber roof, if you see in tie beam roof, you have this tie beam which is running in the center. So maximum space utilization for the churches within in the interiors is only till here. This is actually, this goes above the tie beam. So as well, not usable space. If you see in this trust rafter roofs, they gave maximum space. It is more a linear taller variant of timber roof. This basically originated in the need for sufficient space for the pointed walls beneath it. So pointed walls, as I said, is one of the most important part of the Gothic architecture, and that may be the reason why this evolved. So this roof gave an appearance of a greater height and impressiveness to the interiors. It gave a massive feeling. It gave a huger feeling in the interiors. Each rafter had a collar stiffened by braces which were passed through the collar and stopped at the underside or let through it. So if you see, this is the collar tie. If you see this small part, so this was introduced in this particular type of construction. The rafter rested on the outer portion of the wall, and this left an unsightly ledge on the inside. So there is a triangle thus formed inside, and that originates the hammer beam. See, the hammer beam is another type of roof, wooden roof. That is the hammer beam roofs. Hammer beam rooms is actually an extension of the previous techniques of construction. It evolved around by the end of the 14th century and almost the beginning of the 15th century. It's a much decorative open timber roof which runs in the typical English Gothic architecture churches, and it's actually one of the most spectacular endeavor of the English medieval carpenter. It's considered to be the most amazing and spectacular construction technique of an English Gothic touch, let alone the timber roof. It's actually, as a whole in the English Gothic architecture, this is considered to be a masterpiece of construction. If you see in this particular hammer beam roof, you see this is the hammer beam. If you see here, this is the hammer beam. And hammer beam is a lengthened sole piece on which the projecting parts are supported. See, this is the projecting part, and it is supported on this hammer beam. So this forms a major part of this construction. That is why it's named after that and called the hammer beam roofs. And it consists of a series of trusses repeated at intervals. It's not as a single truss like the previous construction. You can see multiple trusses repeated in intervals to support and supported on the intermediate purlins and rafters. The basic objective is to transmit the weight and thrust to the roof and low down as possible to the supporting wall. So that is this hammer beam construction. Moving on, the next timber roof is the collar based roof. See, if you can see, it's almost pretty similar, as in you can see how it evolved from the beginning and how each and every small stages gave up to the collar braced roof, which is the one of the most advanced form of timber roof construction in the churches. So it's basically a simplification of this hammer beam form. If you see in hammer beam form, you have these kind of arches which actually made these kind of projections in the roof. So if you see in collar beam roof, those were simplified and made into a much simpler looking form, and it gave more space and intrinsicity to the roof. So if you see the collar, once you omit this collar of the collar beam, then it is called the arch base roof. And the curved braces serve to strengthen the trusses while they transmit the weight lower down the wall. That actually makes this roof steady. Moving on to the final type of timber roof, it's the ale roof. See, ale roof is a very simple type of roof, and it doesn't, it's a very simple character roof. If you see it, it mainly began as a continuation of the nave and rafters, that's all. So the trusses were introduced in order to introduce purlins. So if you see, this is a basic aisle roof. If you see, a lot of palace church had such roof, and it is pretty simple and straight and easy looking, and it gives a much simpler interior finish. Moving on to the French Gothic architecture, as I told in the previous lecture, there is a lot of difference between the English Gothic architecture and the French Gothic architecture. These two form the basis of the Gothic architecture across Europe. On an architecture standpoint, if you see, the France is divided into two parts by the River Loire. River Loire is one of the most important river of France, and if you see, the architecture of France also equally distributes itself or divides itself into two distinctive parts based on this River Loire itself. So based on geography, based on climate, architecture from north to south varied in France. And as I said before, France had this excellent collection of stones, and these building stones were extensively used in this particular French Gothic buildings. And before the establishment of the country of France, the France was under Hugh Capet, who became the king of the French. So it was not called the country of France, he was called the king of the French. And then the country became homes of much varied races and different types of people from different part of the world, and there were so many internal wars with each other at that point of time, and that actually gave rise to much varied type of architectural features within France itself. This basically affected the Romanesque and Gothic architecture in France, and these architecture, you can see spectacular variations because of this racial differences within the country itself. So in this presentation, now you can see the basic French Gothic churches. This is the basic parts of a French Gothic church. If you see, you have the tower. Every west facade of this a French Gothic church will have two towers, which actually formed a major part of the French Gothic architecture, and then a gable. Then arcades. Arcades are a part of any Gothic church, if you see, and in France especially, it became a very, very important part of it. The rose window. Rose window is nothing but a central circular window of in the facade of a Gothic church. And as in England, in France also, it became like a huge part of their Gothic architecture. If you see, then there are niches and there are pinnacles, and there is archivolt and jamb and tympanum like in other Gothic churches. So before moving on to the basic architecture of French churches or cathedrals, I would like to take you through a few basic definitions which will actually help you once you know, while learning this churches. The first one is a gargoyle. If you see, this is a picture of a gargoyle. It's nothing but a carved form of grottoes with a spout, which is designed to convey water from the roof and away from the side of the building. So if you see, this is nothing but a water disposal spout which was created in most of the Gothic churches. Like, I, you know, consider this as one of the most extraordinarily modern architectural features. They understood that rainwater had to be taken off, and they created an architecture feature that actually used to sprout out the water, and that is gargoyle, and it's one of the most important feature of a Gothic church. The next is the flesh. Flesh is a steeple or a spire, especially in a Gothic style. If you see Notre Dame has one of the most important and famous flesh of Gothic architecture, which you will see later. So this emerges from the ridge of a roof. And then is the Corinthian capital. Corinthian capital is the most honored of the capital orders, and it is characterized by slender fluted columns and elaborate capitals with acanthus leaves and scrolls. If you see, this has extremely elaborate works, compared to other columns, and there are many, many variations of Corinthian orders that you can see in the later architecture of churches. Moving on, the first church we will be seeing today is the Notre Dame Paris. See, the Notre Dame Paris, or simply Notre Dame, is one of the most exquisite and most famous churches in the world, let alone in Paris. This is one of the fabulous masterpieces of Gothic architecture, not only in France but also in the world. It's considered to be the extreme Gothic cathedral. If you see, Notre Dame in Paris is not only famous for its extraordinary architecture, but also it has a lot of Catholic relics, originals, which is actually saved within this particular church, and that makes this one of the most famous churches and one of the most visited churches in the world. See, if you see, this is the basic plan of Notre Dame Paris. Notre Dame was constructed between 1163 to 1235. It was almost 800 to 900 years old, and it is it took almost 200 years, around 180-200 years to construct this particular church. And Notre Dame means for Our Lady of Paris. It's directly direct translation of Notre Dame Paris means for Our Lady of Paris. It's as I said, it's one of the oldest French Gothic cathedral, and it was begun by Bishop Maurice de Sully. It is not yet established if it was accidental or if it was intentional, but Notre Dame had an axial plan, which is pretty different from other churches of Gothic origin. Another thing about Notre Dame is Notre Dame is one of the first churches in France which use a flying buttresses. Flying buttresses were not intentionally a part of this particular church, but later, when after this construction started, the thinner walls were longer and higher, and that gave a lot of stress marks on this particular church, and the architects came up with the idea of providing flying buttresses in order to support those walls, and that's when this flying buttresses, the much famous flying buttresses of this particular church, came into existence. So it's located in one of the little islands in the middle of the river Seine, and 2000 years ago, this particular part was the only little island which contained Paris. Paris grew, Paris expanded, but this particular island remains the most visited part of Paris, and Notre Dame still remains there. Another thing about Notre Dame is it has a plaque which actually marks the center of the city of Paris. If you see, the Paris city is actually measured from that particular plaque which is in the Notre Dame. Moving on, another unbelievable fact of this beautiful building was it was in such a bad state in the 19th century that people wanted it demolished. So basically, the great writer Victor Hugo helped to save it through his famous book, The Hunchback of Notre Dame. The Hunchback of Notre Dame, again, as I said, refers to the gargoyle of Notre Dame, which actually is one of the most prominent feature of this particular cathedral. Outside this cathedral, you will see a lot of gargoyles placed like this, around the example which I gave while I explained the gargoyle. This is particularly the gargoyle of the Notre Dame, and this is the Hunchback of Notre Dame. And if you see, the whole church had this particular feature around the church, and previously it was colored, and later on now the color is faded off and is colorless, but previously it was all colored and it was all around this Gothic church. So basically, this particular church has wide nave and double aisles, and transepts or small projections practically in line with aisles, and a notable chevet, the earliest of its kind. A chevet is nothing but semicircular ending of the apse, if you see this, and double aisles and surrounding chapels with existing between the buttresses. The facade was impressive yet somber, and so was the interior. Interior was a little somber, but it was extremely impressive and has nave arcade with cylindrical columns and Corinthianesque capitals carrying the pointed arches, And pointed arches, as I said, is one of the most important part of a Gothic church. And Notre Dame was no different. Notre Dame has extremely pointed arches, which actually became an important part of the Notre Dame interiors. And it has shaft to support the ribs if the loft is sexpertise vaulting. Sexpertise vaulting is another important part of a Gothic church. And as in the Notre Dame, Paris, if you see, this is extensively used. And the sexpertise vaulting of Notre Dame, Paris, is one of the most famous of the sorts in Gothic architecture. Moving on, if you see, you have a triforium, a high triforium, which is binded on an upper triforium with circular windows, which were removed in order to provide taller clerestory windows. Triforium is nothing but a blind story space beneath the sloping roof over the aisle vault and enclosed on the nave by a side of series of arches, as I explained in the previous lecture itself. So the circular clerestory windows next to the crossing were reinstated by the Violet Day Dock, and this became one of the major important part of the Notre Dame Paris. The clerestory windows are much elaborate, that the interiors are very much lighted and gives nave a life of its own. So this is the facade of Notre Dame Paris. You see, this is the southern tower, and this is gallery, one gallery. And if you see, this is a rose window, which I was talking about, which forms the major part of a Notre, you know, a Gothic cathedral. This is a King's Gallery. If you see, a lot of statues, series of statues were made intrinsically carved in this particular area. It's one of the most outstanding feature of French Gothic churches, also Notre Dame. This is the portal of Last Judgment, this is the portal of Virgin, and this is the portal of Saint Anne. Moving on, the wide spreading western facade is one of the finest architectural characteristic facade in France as such. Not just in you know, amongst churches, this particular facade is discussed forever, as in this became a base with which a lot of other cathedral took examples from and was built later. The plan as well as the facade of this particular cathedral became so famous that many churches got inspired from this particular cathedral's plan and facade. Three deeply recessed portals, as I said, these three deeply recessed portals adorn the exterior facade of this particular church. And the central doorway is divided by a pillar in center with a statue of Christ, as you can see in this picture. This particular feature, the central part, is one of the most fabulous extensively carved statue of Christ you can see. And above and across stretches a band of statues of kings of France. So these are all the statues of kings of France. You see this, that is why this is called the King's Gallery. Moving on, the central wheel window is of great beauty and is 42 feet in diameter. This particular rose window is one of the most famous rose windows in the world. If you see rose, if you ask for an example of rose windows, the first example which people actually will give you is a rose window of Notre Dame Paris, because it's 42 feet in diameter and is of great beauty and is intrinsically carved like no other ones. It's flanked by high coupled windows and two western towers and high pointed louvered openings. If you see, these are the two western towers. Moving on to the Amiens Cathedral, France. This is the next cathedral which we'll be discussing today. This is also called Notre Dame Amiens, and this again dedicated to the Lady of Amiens. And this is another very important French Gothic church, and this had extremely different plan and extremely different interiors from the previous churches. This was constructed between 1220 to 88 by Robert de Lusaches, and it's a typical French cathedral, 450 feet long and 150 feet wide. It transepts only widely projecting and sweeping chevet of 7. So a chevet, this chevet of this particular church is extremely famous because of its design. If you see, this is the chevet, particular its apsidal eastern termination of a church choir, typically having surrounding ambulatory that opens into a number of radiating apses. If you see, there are like a lot of radiating apses here, and this is a particular example of a shiver. And shiver of this particular church is very much discussed, and because of its extremely intricate architecture. See, the noble interior and is very spacious in its architecture, and it is like really high, and it seems to enclose, rather than enclosing, it seems to hold the sky within. If you see, it's so tall, and the clerestory windows are like so many that it almost feels that it includes the sky above within its architecture, and that's like the most fabulous feature of this particular church. And the stone vault is 140 feet in height, and it's upheld by cylindrical columns with four smaller attached columns. If you see, the great glory of this cathedral, the Bible of Amiens, is the wonder of its carved woodwork. This has extensively carved woodwork which looks like branches of a living tree soaring high. If you see here, you can see extremely carved and extensively brilliantly made roof in this particular church becomes one major part of this cathedral. Again, the western facade of this cathedral, one of the noblest among the wonderful facades in France. France had amazing architecture like Notre Dame, Paris, and Amiens Cathedral. These two cathedrals has extensively worked out western facade, which is like the face of France, and even now French tourism highly strives upon these two cathedrals as much as that of Eiffel Tower, which later came in. So if you see, a series of statues somewhat resemble the Notre Dame. As I said, Notre Dame also had a statue of Christ in the center, even this had. So the series of statues in this particular cathedral, yes, it did some resemble the Notre Dame a lot, but then this is different in its own way, and this is landmark in its own way. The central western doors are separated by one of the noblest sculptured image in the world of Beauty of the Amiens, and this is particularly famous across the globe, and it's 180 feet in height. The slender timber flesh of this particular church is 180 feet in height. If you see, this is the slender timber flesh of this particular cathedral in France. So this is very, very, very famous about this cathedral. Moving on to the summary, in this particular lecture, you saw the timber roof churches and its types, its evolution, its examples, how much it was important, how much it was used in the English architecture. The French Gothic architecture, how it was influenced, how it became what it is today. We saw the example of Notre Dame in Paris, its architecture features, its gargoyles, and how it evolved, and how it saw different stages of construction, how it reached what it is today. And the Amiens Cathedral, and it's also Gothic architectural style and features. Moving on to some questions. Explain timber roof architecture in England with its types and examples. Illustrate French Gothic architecture with the architecture of Notre Dame, Paris. Explain French Gothic architecture with any example. Explain the architecture of Amiens Cathedral. In the next lecture, you will see another another important landmark of the church architecture. Thank you.